So there's a few different ways to look at this presentation. One of them is me getting an obsession, a personal obsession out of my system. The other way to look at it is as a cry for help. And then the third way is as a challenge, because I'm going to talk about a really quite difficult IoT problem and what we can learn from the problem. And if anyone's got knows how to solve this problem, I'll be interested. But in this little talk, I'll talk about some of the reasons why it is kind of hard to solve. So, hey Siri, turn down my air conditioning. Hey Siri, I said, turn down my air conditioning. Damn it. Okay, Google, turn down my air conditioning. Cortana? Bixby? Maybe even Alibaba can help me. But no, nobody can help. And so, sounds like a first world problem, doesn't it, really? You know, air conditioners, you know, staying cool. But actually, it's quite a big problem, and I'll tell you why. But first, I'll tell you a little bit about why I am entitled to bitch and complain about this problem. So this is me. But, you know, I first got involved in, well, the first time I heard IoT was in 2007. An entrepreneur in Perth told me about this thing called Internet of Things. And you know, in one way or another, through investing in energy technology and various other technologies, this, you know, I've seen this grow and grow over a period of time, but it really is about connecting the physical and digital world. Fairly recently, about 6 months ago, I was at AGL. I was there for 2.5 years, and I was there to bring some Silicon Valley to AGL. We did some interesting things. You probably heard of the 1,000 battery VPP at AGL. So basically, you know, 1,000 batteries operating as one. Another interesting project we did was a smart AC battery and solar trial down in the United Energy Patch down in Melbourne. And so we actually were able to get a fleet of around 80 of these air conditioners during the hottest day of the year to turn up and down. And we got really high customer satisfaction from it. But we didn't really solve the problem. So what is it? So first thing is, customers call the shots these days. Okay, so 25% of homes, as of, you know, I think last month, now have solar on their roofs. 20,000 home batteries will get installed this year. And these are all, this has been enabled to an extent by IoT. The reason you can offer, you know, zero down solar and so forth is because you're able to put an IoT meter, like a watcher, on the solar. The reason you can finance a battery and get the benefit of its multiple streams of value is by having an embedded device in there that's controllable, and you can control them as a fleet. And so we've kind of got these really relatively well solved, but here's the problem. And this particular graphic comes from the government of South Australia, which is quite apt, because, you know, as you know, South Australia's had a few problems with their power system. And what you can see there is that big red slice of the pie, 40%, is heating and cooling. And in Australia, with our relatively mild climate, it's mainly the cooling. And so, but that's not, the fact that most of the energy we use is driven by air conditioners is not really the problem. This is the problem. And so along the bottom, you can see the percentage of the year. And on the y-axis, you can see the demand. And what you can see is on those few days of the year is what's driving the whole capacity that you need. So maybe it's Christmas Day. You've got the whole family there. You've got two microwaves going. You've got a turkey in the oven. You've got all the Xboxes playing. You've got big screen TVs all running at the same time. But remember, 40% of that's your aircon. And that's what's driving that big peak. And that's what causes these big problems, particularly on hot days. So that's why it's really important to control air conditioners. And in the rest of the world, that's happening. So here, this is for the US. You can see 13% of US homes have smart thermostats. And you can see how that's grown over very, you know, from around 4 or 5% a few years ago to where it is now. Most of the population of the US can now get a thermostat for free from the utility, which will enable their their air conditioning to be controlled to the benefit of the consumer. It's going to save them money, but also to the benefit of the network in terms of reducing that peak load. We've got companies like Google Nest, Comcast, which is a pay TV company, are in this space serving demand response into the PGA market and so forth. We've got Amazons and Best Buys building installed service, the capability to service you with these technologies and integrate them for you in their home, okay? It's all happening, but not really in Australia. And we have a big problem, and that big problem is that thing in the background there is a split AC system. So there aren't centrally controlled AC systems like there are in the United States. So you might have multiple of these split systems in your home, and you've got to be able to interface somehow with those systems. And most of these systems are split systems provided by Japanese and Korean manufacturers. They all have their own closed protocol, so it's not like you can easily do an interface with them. You could try messing around with an IR blaster, okay, which is basically imitating, if you like, the remote control, but with an electronic interface. The user experience that is really quite horrible. You know, trying to set up all these codes, get them to work and so forth. You know, your average consumer is not going to adopt IR blaster technology at scale. Okay, we've also got a thing called AS4755, which is basically stealth control of the air conditioners by the local network service provider. And so, if you buy a air conditioner in Queensland, it's got one built into it. And then on the hottest day, they'll just decide when they feel like turning off your air conditioning or turning it down. But it's very blunt, it's very, very rough form of control. Okay, so all in all, that makes it really hard to aggregate all these ACs together. is it the interface? Well, I don't think it's the interface, and I think here's the thing, don't come to me and say, I've just invented this fantastic hub and the hub can connect to the air conditioner and we'll get it all under control, because I'll tell you why. Number one is, again, in the same way the consumers are calling the shots about installing solar and batteries, the consumers are also calling the shots about how they would like to interface with their homes, okay? Now maybe this is mainly driven by music and asking questions about how's the weather or the commute, but they're the decisions. So one of these players is gonna win. I'm not sure if it's gonna be Lysol, but that's who's gonna control the interface. Now, why are these things so cheap? Okay, a couple of $100, okay? Why? Because you're giving your data to these companies, and those companies are then reusing it for other purposes. Okay, I had an interesting discussion from a guy from the New South Wales Transport, and he's in their IT division, and I was walking the station. He was telling me how the state of New South Wales basically buys Google data, Google Maps data, in order to put the traffic advisories on the freeways around Sydney, okay? So that's why they're so cheap. So it's unlikely that your hub device is going to be able to be as cheap as these devices, okay? And in the end, these devices are just a pile of semiconductors and some PCBs and stuff like this. I used to make mobile phones and printers for HPs and Motorola's and all these things. And in the end, it's just a pile of nuts and bolts and things. And so, it's all about the volume, the scale at which you can do and how well you can distribute them. So you've got to use these interfaces, and a hub is just gonna add another layer of cost, and how am I gonna pay back that extra layer of cost with the consumer? Okay, it's great to say, well, in the future, all these different things will happen in the home, and the overall benefit to the consumer is going to be this. Okay, and my hub only costs this. Okay, the problem is you've also got the installation cost. So I've got to get Jim here to send out one of his electricians to go and install the damn thing. Okay, then what I really find is when I try to sell it to the consumer the first time, I'm only selling one use case. So even though all these use cases together might add up to that, when I sell it, I've got to sell them on one use case. And I've already blown that away with the cost of the device plus the cost of the installation, never mind the bandwidth and so forth. So how do we get machine-to-machine control of the split AC? AS4755 is one way to do it. It's a very blunt instrument. We're going to have trust problems around turning things off without the consumer's permission and so forth. You can put an energy hub in, but you've got a cost-to-value ratio that's really hard to solve. You could use the smart meter, and I'm hoping to get a rise out of Jim here, and he'll say, yeah, the smart meter can do it, but I don't think he is. So, you know, smart meter is going to be there for 10 years, okay? So is it going to be able to stay relevant? How am I going to connect all the way from the smart meter to whatever relay or the controls? You know, how do I know I'm going to recover the additional cost of putting all these smarts into a smart meter? And anyway, here in Australia, we've got a beautiful regulatory regime that makes sure the smart meter is the dumbest possible device that you can install. So, oh man, still haven't solved the problem. And then you've got this. This is a meter box just full of junk, okay? And so the first thing Jim's got to do is make some space in there. So this was taken at Wynyard Station on the way here yesterday, and I sort of loved it. And you know, genuinely, these companies in Japan and Korea and now China, like Media is one of the biggest suppliers of split AC systems worldwide. You know, they genuinely are innovative companies, but they have a job. What's the job? It's the same job at GE. Okay, I'm trying to get another rise here. To move metal, okay? They want to move metal. And so what is their incentive to put the controls into these devices, okay? It's going to add cost to the device. Now, arguably, adding that cost is relatively low if you do it at this point rather than having to get Jim to do it at a later point. But you're still adding cost when all these guys really want to do is move metal, okay? You're creating an issue for them in terms of how do you support all these devices in the field? They're not used to doing that. They're used to pushing these units through a supply chain, through a very fragmented supply chain of literally thousands and thousands of small developers, okay? So they don't actually have a lot of incentive to do it. Now, some of the more innovative characters like Samsung, they have their Smart Things program, and they've tried to put their Smart Things hubs into their TVs and things like that, but yet they seem to want to, really, they just want to control that ecosystem. So they seem to want to copy Sony, even though there's been no, you know, Sony's not, you know, has never proved that having a closed walled garden sells any more units or creates in a better experience for consumers. So I think ultimately it has to get to this. How do we get there? I don't know. How do we get people to jump out of their particular slot in this whole value chain and into a slot down here with which they've got no experience? Who's going to run all that? Is that going to be the telcos? Is it going to be the energy companies? I don't know. It's a really difficult IoT problem. I don't know how to solve it. Help me out. Bear these things in mind. Consumers are making the shots, not the utilities. Consumers are making the investment decisions, so you've got to cater to the consumers. And that's shifting the way we manage the electricity system. It's making it more complicated. We need to deliver value to consumers if we want their support. We may have to take a long-term view because the initial value we deliver is very low compared to the actual cost of getting that capability in there. So in the end, it's really about, you know, meeting a customer need and then dealing with this supply chain that wasn't really designed for IoT and designed for the distributed problems we have today. Thank you.